It is now time for part four of my ongoing project to profile the leaders of every country in the world. Today we finish up the seas, mostly. So to begin with, we have country number 34, Chad. The president of Chad is Idriss Déby Itno. He is the former head of the Chadian armed forces who seized power in a 1990 military coup. The fact that he has been in power for this long is considered quite a heroic accomplishment by Chadian standards. Chad's post-independence years have been mostly dominated by a series of terrible civil wars, made all the worse by the intervention of Chad's various awful neighbors. Running Chad means having to deal with constant crap from Libya, and Boko Haram guys coming from Nigeria, and Arab militias coming out of Sudan, and whatever other nonsense these places produce. President Déby has been a big ally of the West as a military strongman who basically hates all the same people we do. Déby is also known for having a large and dysfunctional family that fills all of the different nooks and crannies of Chadian politics. His fourth wife runs the country's oil industry, for instance. And by fourth wife, I don't mean that he's been divorced a bunch of times, I mean literally the fourth consecutive woman that he has married. In a sign of warming relations between Chad and Sudan, in 2012, he also married the daughter of one of the guys responsible for the Darfur genocide. So that's fun. Number 35, Chile. The president of Chile is Sebastián Piñera. He has been president since March of 2018, but he was previously president from 2010 to 2014 as well. For the last 12 years, the Chilean presidency, in fact, has bounced back and forth between the same two people. President Piñera is a conservative and also Chile's third richest man. His first election back in 2010 was a big deal since it marked the first time that a conservative had come to power in Chile since the fall of the dictator Augusto Pinochet in 1990. During that period of dictatorship, a lot of Chile's conservative politicians had served in Pinochet's cabinet, including Piñera's brother, and this basically discredited conservative politics for a generation in Chile. Piñera's first term was all about conservative reform after 20 years of left-wing rule. This wasn't popular with voters, but luckily Piñera did not have to face them, since the Chilean constitution has this weird rule that says that presidents cannot run for direct re-election. So some other guy from his party ran in his place, and he lost to the left-wing president that had come before Piñera. And then when her popularity slumped and she wasn't allowed to run for another term, Piñera was able to come back and run again and get back in. The Chileans introduced this system to ensure that their politics would not always just be dominated by the same person. Number 36, China. The president of China is Xi Jinping, who is one of the world's most famous leaders, as presidents of China tend to be. Xi was promoted to be president of China by the Chinese Communist Party in 2012, completing his long slog to the top of the communist hierarchy. His rise through the hierarchy was actually considered this uniquely Chinese rags-to-riches story, considering that his father had actually been purged by Chairman Mao, so Xi had to work extra hard to reclaim the family name. In contrast to the two Chinese leaders who came before him, who were just kind of boring party apparatchiks, as the commies say, President Xi is known for being China's most ambitious leader in a generation. He is very committed to making China this big world power while also consolidating the strength of the communist dictatorship at home. So his administration has been defined by a number of high-profile foreign policy initiatives, as well as increasing domestic surveillance and crushing political dissent and consolidating government control over the Chinese economy. And he is just getting started, since earlier this year he also amended the Chinese constitution to allow him to rule for life. Number 37, Colombia. The president of Colombia is Iván Duque, who was just elected this past June. He is fairly young, only 41 years old, and he comes from this brand new upstart right-wing populist party that was only founded in 2014. He was educated in economics in the United States and speaks very nice English.
You need to get the biggest economies growing and don't blockade the development of the access to free markets.
Duque has sort of been slotted in with this kind of, you know, large movement of populist politicians sweeping to power all over the world. But is Duque really that much of an outsider? In all of the articles you read about him, much is always made about how close he is to Colombia's previous right-wing president, Álvaro Uribe, and how Uribe was like his mentor and sort of orchestrated his whole political career, and now views his presidency as sort of like his de facto third term, since in the Colombian system you cannot actually run for a third term. Colombia is best known for its half-century civil war against drug-dealing communists, which right-wingers, as you might expect, traditionally take a pretty hard line on. A peace deal to end the civil war was approved by the previous liberal administration, but conservative politicians like Mr. Duque and Mr. Uribe said it was no good because it was too soft on the rebels. So now you have this whole interesting situation where the new government charged with implementing the peace treaty is actually opposed to it, which means that when you read about Colombia these days, you see a lot of headlines about uncertainty. Number 38, the Comoro Islands. The Comoro Islands, also known as the Union of the Comoros, is a group of three islands off the coast of East Africa. Now, for such a small place of less than a million people, the Comoro Islands have probably been one of the worst-run countries in the world. Their political history is nothing but coups and counter-coups, and separatist movements, and failed power-sharing agreements between the three islands. Their current president is Colonel Azali Assoumani, who first took power in a 1999 military coup following the breakdown of negotiations over a new constitution. He proved more competent at getting a new constitution implemented and was then elected president in his own right in 2002. But under that new constitution, the presidency was required to switch every 4 years between the three different islands. So in 2006, it was island number two's turn to pick the president, and then in 2011, it was island number three's, and then in 2016, it was island number one's turn again, and they voted Colonel Azali back to power. And Azali had clearly grown tired of this whole cockamamie rotating president scheme, so last month he got rid of it. The new system basically just lets him stay in power forever. He also made Sunni Islam the island's official religion in what is seen as a way to suck up to Saudi Arabia and get some more money out of them. I mean, you can't pay the bills on political unrest alone. Number 39 is the Republic of Congo. Their president is Denis Sassou-Nguesso. Much like the president of Chile and Comoros, President Sassou-Nguesso has held office on two non-consecutive occasions. Sassou-Nguesso is a military man by training, and in the 1970s, he served as defense minister in the communist government that was running Congo at the time. Then, when the president resigned in 1979, he became the new president. After the Cold War ended, Congo embraced democracy, and the people voted Sassou-Nguesso out. But, as you might expect, he did not go quietly, and there was 4 years of civil war pitting his supporters against supporters of the new president. And in the election that followed that, Sassou-Nguesso was voted back in. And that was basically the end of Congo's brief experiment with democracy, since getting back in, Sassou-Nguesso has proceeded to nestle himself in nice and tight. He has gotten rid of presidential term limits and age limits, and all of the subsequent elections have basically just been big corrupt jokes. Number 40 is the other country that is also named Congo, the Democratic Republic of Congo. This is the one that is considered the bad Congo, although the other one doesn't sound that great either. So the DRC used to be known as Zaire, and it was run for 30 years by this bad guy named Mobutu Sese Seko. And in 1997, he was overthrown by this other bad guy named Laurent Désiré Kabila. During this whole period, something like 3 million people died. And Laurent Désiré Kabila was assassinated in 2001, which brought his son Joseph Kabila to power, and he hasn't been great either. During the days when his father was running around trying to overthrow the government, he was just working as a cab driver in Tanzania. They say he never really wanted to be president and doesn't like the job, which might explain why he's so bad at it, and why after 17 years in power, Congo remains as poor and violent and oppressive as ever. But what President Kabila does like is money. Since taking office, he has run a regime of breathtaking corruption and personal enrichment, in which he lives a lifestyle of decadent luxury while his people remain among the world's poorest. According to this New York Times story, he is so rich he wears a Patek Philippe watch on one hand and a Rolex on the other, and rather than run the country, he prefers to just stay in his mansion and play PlayStation 4. Earlier this month, President Kabila agreed to step down, and everyone said, good. Number 41 is Costa Rica. El presidente de Costa Rica es señor Carlos Alvarado. He was elected in April of this year. So Costa Rican politics seem a lot like politics in the US. On the one side, you have a conservative party that is very heavily influenced by evangelical Christians. And then on the other side, you have a left-wing party influenced by secular progressives. The recent Costa Rican presidential election featured two candidates who were very representative of these two tribes. You had a former evangelical preacher versus a left-wing writer in his 30s, and they were given the perfect issue to mobilize their respective bases, because right in the middle of the campaign, the Latin American Supreme Court, which is apparently a thing, ruled that all Latin American countries have to have gay marriage. So the whole election wound up being about that, And the pro same-sex marriage candidate, Senor Alvarado, ended up winning. President Alvarado appointed a black woman to be his vice president, and upon taking office, he created a perfectly gender-balanced cabinet, a la Justin Trudeau. So you can see that the times are really changing in those Catholic countries down there. Number 42 is Côte d'Ivoire. The president of this country, also known as the Ivory Coast, is Alassane Ouattara. He was elected in 2010 in a very close election that caused his country a lot of turmoil because the guy that he beat, the incumbent president, refused to leave office. So for 4 months after the election, there was a lot of violence as supporters of the two candidates battled in the streets. It only ended when France basically invaded the country and started shooting rockets at the presidential palace until he left and Ouattara could move in. President Ouattara is an economist by training. He went to school in the US and spent a lot of time working for the International Monetary Fund in Washington. Though he served briefly in the cabinet of one of the Ivory Coast's old presidents, he has had a hard time making a political career for himself, in large part because the Ivory Coast has an extremely xenophobic political culture. So all of the other politicians would make a big deal of where Ouattara went to school and worked, and the fact that his mother was an immigrant from a different African country, and the fact that he married a white woman. It wasn't until 2002 that children of immigrants were even allowed to run for president of Côte d'Ivoire. So you can see that issues of bigotry and identity are pretty universal all over the world. Number 43 is Croatia. The president of Croatia is Kolinda Grabar-Kitarovic. She won a very narrow surprise victory in 2015, unseating Croatia's incumbent president. President Grabar-Kitarovic is a conservative, which makes some people nervous because that particular part of the world has had some historic trouble with right-wing nationalism. But the president says there's nothing to worry about. She saves all of her nationalistic energy for World Cup games. She is her country's former foreign minister and a longtime diplomat. She was also educated in the US and speaks even better English than that Colombian guy. In fact, I would put her up there with Benjamin Netanyahu as world leader who could probably come the closest to passing as an American.
There was no ethnic cleansing. Yes, it's true that a number of civilian population left because of the operation, but we were inviting them all along to stay in their homes.
And lastly, we have country number 44, Cuba. Now, I'm not really sure who's actually running Cuba these days. I mean, there was big news made back in April when the Cuban parliament appointed this guy, Miguel Diaz-Canel, to be their new president. It was the first time in 4 decades that someone other than Fidel Castro or his brother Raul was allowed to hold that job. But on the other hand, Cuba is also a communist country in which holding the leadership of the party is the most important political position. Fidel Castro was not always president of Cuba during his 49-year rule, but he was always party boss, and leadership of the Communist Party today is still held by Raul Castro, as is the position of commander-in-chief of the Cuban army. Raul says he is not going to leave either of those two jobs until 2021. But in any case, Raul Castro clearly has one foot out the door, and Miguel Diaz-Canel is the new face of the government. So what's his deal? Well, he is pretty boring, honestly. He is basically just a career communist politician, much like President Xi in China. He has worked his way through the hierarchy, holding a bunch of different jobs until finally getting promoted to the top one. But unlike President Xi, this guy does not seem like much of a visionary. He is usually portrayed as just being an incredibly loyal tool of the regime. Somebody with no big ideas who does not want to rock the boat in any way, albeit with a little bit less of the constantly tottering on the brink of death vibe that Cuba's previous two presidents had. So yes, that is another 11 world leaders done for you. So we are now about 1/6 of the way through. Why did I agree to do this?